Thank you for your presence. Now we are going to start the first plenary session. We would like to invite Mrs. Ari Asnani, PhD, as moderator of first plenary session to come forward.
Mrs. Ari Asnani, PhD, graduated from University of Guelph, Canada. Now she is a lecturer at Department of Chemistry, Universitas Jenderal Sudirman, majoring biochemistry.
For the first plenary session, we'd like to invite three remarkable speakers.
First, Professor Dr. Hassan Y. Abouin from Egypt, please come forward.
Second, Professor Dr. Jarwani S. Joko from Universitas Indonesia.
The third, Professor Dr. Ahmad Zuhairi Abouin. Professor Dr. Ahmad Zuhairi Abdullah from Malaysia, please come forward.
In this plenary session, we will be led by Mrs. Ari Asnani, PhD. Therefore, Mrs. Ari Asnani, PhD, the time is yours.
Prof. Jarwani is one of the few senior faculties in the Department of Physics, University of Indonesia. She obtained her PhD in the field of biophysics from Institute of Technology Bandung. Professor Jarwani is still active in research and teaching, as well as tutoring students in the field of medical physics. She has published a number of publications in her field in the national and international journals. She is the founder of the Medical Physics Division in the Department of Physics, and she is also a founder of the Indonesia Federation Organization for Medical Physics and Biophysics. Right now, she is the Council Expert in Biomaterial Society Indonesia. For her service and dedication, she has been awarded with the Satya Lencana Karya for 30 years. Do we have Professor Ahmad Zuhairi Abdullah right now? Is she missing in action? Calling Professor Abdullah. Oh, thank you. Now, here you come. Professor Dr. Ahmad Zuhairi Abdullah from University Sains Malaysia is currently the Deputy Dean Research Postgraduate and Network at the School of Chemical Engineering, University of Malaysia. He got his PhD in the field of chemical process technology and chemical engineering. He has been a registered chemist with Malaysian Institute of Chemistry since since 2005. His research works mostly encompass chemical reaction involved in oleochemical conversion, waste treatment, green technology, and production of renewable energy sources, which are definitely relevant and strategic to Malaysia economy. Some of them involve collaboration with industries such as Felda with WD Media, Pacific Wet Foods, and Citera to solve their problems and to improve efficiency in order to remain competitive in the future. He is an evaluator to research proposals received from the university local ministries as well as international scientific associations such as American Chemical Society and the Qatar National Research Foundation. He is one of the recipients of the Top Research Scientist Malaysia 2014 Award, and his index corpus is currently stands at 32. That's all the brief introduction, the curriculum vitae of the all speakers that we have this morning. So without overdue, we are going to give Professor Hassani Al-Anim to start his presentation entitled Application of Convergence Chromatography in Chiral Analysis. Prof. Hassan.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sherman. It's a pleasure to receive the invitation to come and address this conference. I would like to, on my behalf and my wife, to thank the Managing Committee for the warm welcome we received and the beautiful smiling faces we received all the way. So this is, actually this is my first visit to Indonesia. And I tell you from now, it's not going to be the last. Come back. Yeah. All right. This lecture is actually a mixture of biotechnology and chromatography, spatial sound combined. Because as you can see from the title, it was a design like this design, and it will be focused for the resolution of racemic mixture to get separation of this racemic for better drug control. That is the type. So before, this is a general lecture. I usually start with the basics and proceed forward. So this is the concept of chirality. The hands, the right and left hand, which are not superimposable. They are not superimposable. Once you switch it 180 degrees, you cannot superimpose the left hand to the right hand. And again, that is the picture showing amino acid left and right, or D and L, and the terminology goes, or S and R, again, this is terminology for the stereochemical configuration, representing the left and hand side. All right, as basic organics, we face several types of stereoisomerism represented by the first type is the mirror plane, which actually you can see an asymmetric center, carbon asymmetric center with four different groups around, and then you have a mirror plane. So this, imagine if you try to pick up this, try to superimpose it here, it's not going to be superimposed. So this, in that case, there are two enantiomeric pairs. There are two enantiomeric pairs. They have all the physical and chemical properties. Everything is the same, except for the direction of polarized light, where we have one go to the left and we call it neurocatalyst, and the other take it to the right and we call it extruder. That's the only difference. And then we have the other type. Here is called the axial scalarity, and the axial scalarity actually is the best tool for representing axial scalarity is the allele, where you have carbon, and sometimes they are either this way, perpendicular to each other, or that way in the outer space. That is the difference. Then we have the other type is the agrovisomers, this one here, and again, these are mainly found in the aromatic groups. So the same one, you have two family groups, and that this family group rotate around the single bond. All right, the trick here is if group A, B, C, D are small atoms, or small group like a hydrogen or maybe a less group, the rotation around these two bend will keep going, so you cannot separate. When the separation happens, or when the isomer happens, when these groups are spherically big, the volume is big enough, so you find sometimes this spinel group again perpendicular to each other, perpendicular around. Perpendicular around the single bond or two isomers. And then finally, the easy one is the geometrical isomers, this one. And the geometrical isomers is represented by cis trans or E and G isomers, and they are easily separated because they are the chemical and physical property are completely different, so you can simply separate. The most difficult type of separation are this one. Because, as I said, they are exactly the same. You look at yourself in front of a mirror, so you see yourself, you don't see somebody else. All right? So, this flowchart simply show you how man usually pollute himself and the environment. So we took a sample of drugs, clinically used drugs. And if you go this way to the natural one, you find Mother Nature give you a high yield of stereospecific drugs, of stereospecific compounds, which are these are the second thing for life. Okay? Yeah. This. And out of this, a large number, if you take the percentage of the 461 to the 469, you find it high enough, that means mother nature or natural flow are quite specific as far as the stereochemistry and the configuration. We all know that. Now, you go to another side of the flow chart and you see these are synthetic, and out of the synthetic only a portion have a chiral characteristic, and out of that, if 422 out of 480 are used and administered as a synthetic. By the way, once we all take drugs of some sort or another. Well, once we administer a racemic drug Actually, we are taking, there is a problem. We are taking an impure, drug. Because there are actually two, you are taking two your drugs. And we'll take just a couple of examples, it's just a list of some of these drugs. We'll take the very famous story of the thalidomide case. The thalidomide was a drug which was used to treat the nausea and vomiting feeling for pregnant ladies during the first trimester. And what happened? That this lady, when they delivered the baby, this baby came deformed. We have a problem in the palate, we have the limbs, problem in the limbs, problem in the leg. It was a disaster. And therefore, the drug was withdrawn from the market. The reason was that drug was taken as a mixture of two. Mixture of two, this and this. Not pure, not the pure one. This one is this what is called the teratogenic effect, the malformation of the fetus. While the other one was the good one, which gave the desired biological activity. Another, and the list goes on. I will give another example again. For example, here, a drug called ketamine. This is a general anesthetic used frequently in hospitals for doing surgery, and it is administered as a racemate. So you find that it's a mixture of two. You find, and maybe you heard that for those of you who underwent surgery, when you recover from the surgical operation, they tell you, and you have been hallucinating, you've been saying things in the past or calling people, dead people, or telling a story which happened way back. Hallucination happened during the recovery. Again, the reason for that is this one, this natural, while this one, the drug which caused the anesthesia problem with minimum side effects. So in essence, the thing is, why we have to go through the separation of the racemate, the mixture of these the two, in order to get the pure desire of drug. One, reduction of total dose. Of course, if I give a mixture of racemate, if I give 100 milligram in order to get the desired blood concentration limit, and that, and because it actually is 50-50 mixture, that means this 100 milligram you give to the patient, it's actually 50% the desired one, and 50 milligram desired one, and 50 milligram undesired one. Okay? The undesired one is not going to go anywhere. It will cause toxicity or it will cause side effect. And that's why you always see, even in the pamphlet, side effects of the drug. So, with this, by using the proper enantema, then you reduce the dose. This number one. Again, you can easily assess the dose response relationship that comes in, because it's a pure, your drug, no more racemate. Again, there will be no variability between patients. And the most important thing is that you reduce toxicity. Because you are eliminating the inactive. Actually, the word inactive here is not correct. You remove the bad one or the unwanted one. Because nothing is inactive. Okay, it has some effect, some side effect, which cause sometimes a problem, lead to toxicity. All right. Then,
This is just a simple graph showing you through the years, and I just, this is a model, never mind, after that. Here you find that the pink represent the marketing of or the production of pure energy. You see, it's always on the rise. Always on the rise. Nowadays, most of the pharmaceutical companies, why do have to market the correct desired energy? Okay? That is why that doesn't come cheap, of course. That's why the prices of recent drugs are sky high. Because it does require purification steps, and that is why the prices of drug now, as I said, really coming up. One tablet cost more than $1,000 in certain cases. Okay? All right. Now, how do we go about this evaluation? There are several techniques you can apply for the separation of the energy. And this includes chromatography, all right, with liquid chromatography, gas chromatography, again with liquid chromatography, with all the sub technique of ABC, capillary electrophoresis, biosensors, membranes, crystallization, the old one, but still good, and biotransformation of all enzymatic kinetic resolution. That's what we are going to talk about today. The enzymatic kinetic resolution. And enzyme everywhere. Any living organism or cell has enzyme. So the enzyme exists in animal, fungus, bacteria, you name it. It's everywhere. And as we all know, enzymes are stereoselected to a particular substrate, okay, in order to carry out the reaction. If that substrate is not the correct one, then no reaction will happen. Okay? This idea of enzymatic resolution came from during World War II by a German company by the name of Libus. And the reason was they want to use L amino acid in particular. L-amino acid only, because mammals in general use only L-amino acid. The D-amino acid is useless. Bacteria can use D-amino acid, but not the mammals. All right, and the resources was limited, so they have designed this reaction by having this hydrogen point in the injection through our RSNS enzyme, it will move towards there will be an equilibrium, of course. Then, with L hydrogenase enzyme, it will open the in the ring right here to get the carbamoyl amino acid. Then, with again the carbamoylase enzyme, it produce the desired L-amino acid. See this? The wedge? This is what they want. Because this wedge, this black wedge, is designated that it's coming to you. It's protruding on you. Not if it is dashed, then it's protruding in the back. But because we are writing the formula on flat surface, we write it this way. But the black wedge mean that this globe is, if you hold it in 3D, that means it's coming out. And if it is dash, that means it's coming left.
Okay.
Now, why gravitations? Why gravitations? Gravitations enzyme, as a matter of fact, is a very interesting enzyme and very affordable. Not only that, it has several, it comes from different sources. One, they have significant activity for the natural substrate and non-natural substrate. It can work, it has a broader scope for the enzymatic reaction. That is why you see later how valuable it is. The second thing is it doesn't require any cofactor. It doesn't need like manganese or zinc or whatever in order to initiate the enzymatic. It's a humble enzyme. It doesn't require much. It doesn't require cofactor. And it catalyzes. It can
carry out the esterification.
It can carry out
esterification and de-esterification. And it can go esterification step, and if you have an ester, it can de-esterify. So it can go both ways. And then we use usually what we call a silent donor. A silent donor is the donor which converts the alcohol or the carboxylic acid to an ester, and usually we use of vinyl acetate or hydrobromine acetate. Still you have to sit there. And another advantage, it is available to
Yeah. Oh, well. And actually, you can use it in a free form or in immobilized form. And when you immobilize it, it's still the activity is retained and well. And actually, it has, as I said in the beginning, exhibit a good to excellent stereocity. That is one target very important. All right.
Amino acid is actually a protein made of, I mean, my base is made as an enzyme, it's made of as a protein which is made of sequence of amino acid. So depending on the sequence in the 3D, the cavity from one lipase to another changes. The lipase coming from the pancreas of human is different from the lipase of the bovin from cow, is different from the lipase coming from candida fungus. They are all lipases, but they differ because the amino acid sequence are different. You find that the cavity, the size of the cavity differ. They're not the same. I wish it were, that makes life easy, but it's not. And in order for the enzymatic reaction to be carried out, that substrate has to go inside this cavity and start binding. Otherwise, no reaction. So, why I'm saying all this? Because, all right, this is a 3D for the human lipase from different sides, up from front, side, bottom, okay? This is not the issue here. I'd like you to see this drawing, and you can see from the side view, the front view, and the top view for different type of lipases,
And you look at the, see the cavity here, it's different than the cavity here, different than the cavity here. You see this cavity here? This is from the side view, from the top view. This is the same. Yeah. Yes, this diagram shows you that these light pages are not the same because the cavity is different. And since the cavity is different, okay, before we get there, I'll go. I'll take a step back. Now I said you can use the light page in a free form or immobilize. How do you immobilize it? You immobilize it through an epoxide reaction. This is an on the terminal, amino acid terminal at the end. This will open and the enzyme will be immobilized on a solid phase. So you catch the enzyme. Don't do it. And you reuse it, and you will see an example later on in the presentation. It's showing this. Now, we have two options to get your energy. Either through a symmetric synthesis for those who love and do organic chemistry. Right? And they can start using chiral catalyst. Chiral catalyst, usually they are rhodium or ruthenium catalyst. Right? In order to get what they want as far as the configuration and the orientation of the groups. However, this method is expensive and not recommended in later stage in the drug group, its efficacy, and the company can invest in the asymmetric synthetic order to produce keen the amount of. But before that, actually, the best practical way to separate is through kinetic resolution. There are two ways again for the enzymatic kinetic resolution. If I have a mixture of holes, R and S, and I start adding a lipase, the lipase will act on one enantiomer, leaving the other behind. Okay? That's nice. But this method has a problem. What is the problem? You lose 50% of your yield. You lose 50% of your yield. Okay? Here, this is a conventional kinetic resolution, only 50%. All right. So what you're going to do? You throw it in the garbage? No. Then you, what happened here that you use the, what they call the dynamic kinetic resolution. That means you have the mixture. The R will act with the lipase, getting the R product. Then the substrate S with the racemes. Of course, the S will not react. This will be left. You put the racemes enzyme here, it will start shifting to the R, and the cycle goes on and on. So, and this way, theoretically, you can go up to the 100% yield. You don't lose nothing. So the dynamic kinetic resolution is more efficient than the conventional one. Because the conventional one, as I said, you lose about 50% of the product. Again, going back to that issue of the cavity inside the enzyme. And this representing a compound in the chiral center right here. The orange, large group, medium group. From the sketch you see, logically, which one will react efficiently with the enzyme? Of
course, this one, A, because it fits properly. It fits properly in the cabinet. While here,
excuse me, Professor.
This is the meeting room. See, this is the end.
Excuse me,
Professor.
You only have five more minutes.
5 more minutes?
Yes.
Okay, we'll go very fast.
I'm really sorry, actually.
It's about 45 minutes. I'll get back since I have a short time. Here is a bunch of airports, primary airports, that you can apply this for the simulation of the result in Antwerp. So, primary airport, all right? Secondary airport, and as another group, okay? And, oh, and in the pharmaceutical field, the beta blockers are extensively used as hypertensive drugs, and most of them, up till now, are used as racemic mixture, which is bad news. But what shall I say? Very few beta blockers are pure in Antwerp, maybe two. The rest are racemic mixture. And this is an airport again. So all of that, can be resolved on using the right place. But the second group is the acid, again, they can be resolved this way. And I will give you an example here. And the effective one is the S-naproxen, and it can be resolved using the prison line, using the same thing with the side and there is a bunch of acidic ones again, which can be resolved that way. Finally, I will just tell you this. I will end up with this slide since the time is up. Menthol is a natural product mainly separated from heparin. We use menthol in any food industry, in confectionery, and pharmaceutical. It's an imaginary product. The menthol, the proper menthol, is an element. So the natural sources is not enough for the need. The demand is more higher than what the mother nature of nature can provide. So it has to be done synthetically. The synthesis starts with beta-cleavage through alkylation, this rhythm reaction to thymol. The thymol is subjected to hydrogenation, and it gives a bunch of potential of methyl, isomethyl, neomethyl, and neoisomethyl. Each of these methyl has two. So actually, after hydrogenation step, you have eight methyl nitrate. All right. You don't need all that. That's not the desire. So by subjecting to the ligase solution, every one of them is left alone, except the end one is transformed to the acetate ester, and the other are in the alcoholic, secondary alcoholic form. We take, separate that, and we can recover the end one too. What about these? Again, that will be waste? No. They will take, again, through racemization step, and it goes to this here, and you keep recycling over and over. Now, hopefully,
that's the essence of application of the Nobel Resolution, okay, in industry, not only pharmaceutical, but also in industry. And if the time permits, I could have come for another 15 minutes to show you some of the recent application of the Nobel Resolution. This, I'm not going to show you the thank you slide, for the thank you slide. So I'll start my day and I thank you for your attention. Yeah. Any comments on this? Oh, okay.
Thank you very much, Professor Hassan. We do apologize for the short time. Actually, I really hate to stop the interesting topics. But since we have a time constraint, now we move to the second speaker, Professor Dr. Jarawan Mesugioko, with the theme entitled Calcium Phosphate as a constituent of ceramic polymer biomaterial. To Professor Jarawan, the time is yours.
The first one, I will talk a little bit about calcium phosphate phases. There is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 phases of calcium phosphate, amorphous calcium phosphates, and four of them will be crystalline, the calcium phosphate, dihydrates of the calcium phosphate, tricalcium phosphate, hydroxyapatite, and I believe that all of you chemists know very well already. This one, amorphous calcium phosphate, is rich of through phosphates, ions, possess low molar ratio of calcium phosphates. According to Termen and Posner, the calcium phosphate ratio is depends on the pH condition in precipitation. Here is four phases of calcium phosphate crystals with different calcium phosphate ratio. DCPG, of course, will be 1, and OCP, octacalcium phosphate, will 1.33, and 3 calcium phosphate will be 1.5, the calcium phosphate ratio, and the hydroxyapatite in here is 1.67. This is the most stable of calcium phosphate. Phase state of calcium phosphate depends on temperature and presence of water. Yeah. At body temperature, only two crystal phases are formed. DCED, calcium phosphate dehydrates, and hydroxyapatite. Hydroxyapatite is the structure in the unite cell, and the volume will be dominated by calcium actually, and by phosphate ions, because also phosphate ions will be approximately diameter 3.7 angstrom, followed by hydroxyl ion and the smallest calcium ion. If the arrangement in the unite cells will be phosphate dominated by phosphate ions, the approximate to close pack hexagonal, and calcium and hydroxyl ions are located and interstitial between phosphate ions. And if you can see the model will be like this. The model here, calcium, calcium here, calcium here. And here is hydroxyl, and this is dominated, the volume is dominated by phosphates. If we talk about biological apatite, biological apatite actually hydroxyl apatite with calcium deficient, non-stoichiometry, and due to substitution of calcium phosphate and OH hydroxyl ions by simple and all complex ions. Therefore, it is named apatite. We call it not hydroxyl apatite, but apatite. Bone apatite is one of biological apatites. The formula you can see if there is a substitution here. Geoceramics used for implants, repair and construction of diseased or damaged body parts are called geoceramics. Hydroxyl apatite is geoceramics, is similar to bone apatite, but geoceramics is very brittle. Yeah. It cannot be used on their own mature load-bearing implants. Therefore, if we want to have a bone replacement, it can be designed to be a ceramic polymer composites. Bone is an apatite, it's a natural apatite collagen composite polymer. It has complex structure. Two level of composite structure in bone. The small size hydroxyl apatite mineral is around 80 nanometer by 20 nanometer to 3 nanometers, and the collagen molecule at about 300 nanometers. Here is the diagram. You can see here the collagen and the hydroxyl apatite in the middle, and bone apatite reinforced collagen. Individual lamella with the size of from nanometer to micrometer scale, and osteotomy reinforced interstitial bone from micrometer to millimeter scale. Collagen is in helical structure. It has a non-helical interacting apatite. Apatite is mineralized at specific location. Collagen is namely as fluorosome. And the important thing is the C-axis of the hexagonal structure of apatite are aligned parallel to collagen fibers. If you see the bone composition, composition will be from the aquatic, collagen, water, and ions and non-collagenous proteins. You can see here that the aquatic is dominated here, 60%. The collagen is estimated 20%, water 90%. And other ions and collagenous proteins are estimated. The toughness of collagen decreases when water is removed from collagen. And also the strength and toughness of collagen will decrease when water is lost from mineral phase. This means water has a really important role in the pool. Here the role of water influences both deformation response and collagen in close proximity of introgeography. Water and collagen are bonded here, collagen are bonded with introgen, and here is introgeography is interacting with water. If we talk about biomaterials, in general, biomaterials should have minimum requirements. The first, here there is 5 requirements. Biocompatible, such as non-toxic, non-carcinogenic, tissue compatible, must not leak or release harmful components in the living system. Possess mechanical properties that must be appropriate for the intended application, and the desired mechanical properties must last for the expected life of implant, and must be also sterilizable. And for designing bioactive composites, here to have combination of the best characteristics of each component. It means if we talk about calcium polymer composites, should we have best characteristics of each component center to provide unique mechanical properties. For medical composite, it should be remembered biological compatibility is more important than mechanical compatibility. At least one of the constituents of material composite should be directed. How did this bioactive that involves chemical bond with polymerization? How did this also osteoconductive permits body and growth and act as support in body tissue? For bone replacement, you have to compose based on similarity with the bone apathy collagen composite at microscopic level. If we can make it closer and closer, it will be very nice. Here, the apathy polymer composite is it can be closer to the hydroxyapatite collagen that will be close similar to bone. The hydroxyapatite polymer composite is bioactive and tough composite, overcoming the brittleness of the hydroxyapatite. If we talk about the reactivity of the composite, determined by the active component of composite will promote the tissue growth, necessary to implant, and formation of strong bone between the implant and host the host tissue after implantation. Factor in the joint performance of the active composites. If we talk about reinforcement particles, two types of reinforcements. It can be in the form of fibers and particles, harder and stronger than the matrix, of course, and his reinforced composite. Properties of geometrical composite influenced by several factors, such as reinforcement between apatite, if you will use apatite, the shape, size, and size distribution. Reinforcement properties and volume percentage, bioactivity of reinforcement, and also the matrix. Matrix properties, molecular weight, grain size, and distribution of the reinforcement in the matrix, and reinforcement matrix implication scheme. Physical characteristics such as shape, size, distribution determine the mechanical properties of composite. The shape of extrusy apatite may be regular, flaky, or acicular. Acicular sometimes as a result is irregular shape is preferred to spherical shape. In the processing, the molding matrix can penetrate to perform particle surface, forms interlock bonding between particles matrix. If shape hydrostatic is acicular, the weight and length ratio and orientation of acicular should be considered. Ceramic particles tend to combine together to make aggregates and further agglomerates. The agglomerates or grit should be broken down into primary particles in order then to disperse the matrix in the genome. Characteristic of ceramic particles, interparticle attraction, particle surface treatment, and particle volume fraction also determine dispersion and distribution in the composite. Since we should have the active composite, your artifice must exceed a certain threshold for the impression. According to Milgram, the threshold volume percentage is around 20%. Second, behavior, the appearance of particle and the matrix is also important besides the volume percentage. Second, behavior, particularly particles, is influenced by the size of particles. When uniform size of particles, it's difficult to achieve the packing density in the matrix. Ceramic powders were generalized and the growth size of distribution, so a measure of specific proportion of two or more size powders. Here is illustration of taking particles having D model size distribution in polymer matrix with diameter of large spherical particles being three times that of small spherical particles. So the distribution will be nicely, and there is no vacancy here in the matrix. Reinforcement of matrix interfacial state affects the mechanical behavior of composite. A strong interfacial bonding is able to transfer effectively the load from the matrix to reinforcement. There is no chemical bonding between reinforcement and matrix in the BMD composite. The bond strength totally due to the mechanical interval between reinforcement particles and matrix. So, maybe the last time I would talk about the coordinator with this fantastic information. For having POFA composite with strength and thickness comparable to the piece that will be replaced. Polymer of IFA or PFA among different grades to be selected. Compromise a polymer selection to be considered, particularly related to processability, the polymer to the production of composite. Because the production of polymer is very viscous and mixed with the particles and the processing systems. Here is the conclusion. The conclusion is the most stable calcium phosphate compound is hydroxyapatite. Good is natural composite material. Consists of apatite as reinforcement particles in collagen matrix. Microscopic apatite collagen composite is developed by active polymer composite as analog by material for communication. And as a consequence of the active collagen polymer composite by material, several properties of reinforcement apatite such as shape, size distribution, forming percentage, reinforcement distribution, reinforcement matrix, interfacial bond in composite should be considered. Thank you very much.
General, because to us, maybe Papua is the one, but to some of the companies, to be similarity between the tank and pot. So usually in the case of pot, we can divide the industry into upstream, which is oil pump division. We produce the oil pump. And also next will be midstream oil pump, meaning we produce crude palm oil. So this is oil, but of course it's not ready for human consumption yet. And downstream processing or downstream industry, we are talking about oil refining and fractionation. Here we talk about what to do with the oil. Okay? So there are many products of general concern in this particular type of industry. Refined oil, it could be on oil, distilling, kernel oil, fatty acid, fatty alcohol, palm fatty acid distillate, kernel cake, and palm kernel fatty acid distillate. But my particular concern for this particular talk would be on the pricing. The pricing is very much produced in this particular type of industry. And usually the wire concerns about the problem that end of the community, right, provided by this particular type of material or substance. Okay. Oil palm, we are producing crude palm oil. So you can see that it is very palm, it is actually very viscous material or substance. And of course it's not ready for human consumption yet. Refining, we are actually refining or filtering through certain purification processes in order for us to get something now is ready for consumption. Okay, we are getting the refined oil, RD oil, refined bleach, derived oil, now is ready for human consumption. But of course, what to do with the material apart from the agricultural purposes? Of course, we get it, we can use it for frying, for cooking, for some other purposes, frying, cooking, and some ingredients for certain food. But at the same time, we can also have a lot of opportunity with palm oil, right? Because actually, palm oil can consist of two different components. One is fatty acid, another is methyl ester. Okay, these are two fatty acid and glycerol, but of course, methyl ester can produce as well as the variability. For different type of ester over here for different purposes, but of course glycerol is the concern there. Glycerol is also produced at the same time because currently the main concern is on the fatty acid, on the metal acid. But of course people don't really pay special attention to the glycerol because we are actually producing that the glycerol at very high rate, far away beyond the need or beyond the demand in the industry. So that is actually oversupply of glycerol currently in the market, and what to do with it, how to deal with it, that is the question. And we are producing fatty alcohol and also fatty amines, okay, for your process. So these are actually established products from polychemical or palm oil splitting. At the same time, so we really focus for my presentation today will be on the glycerol. Okay, what to do with it? Glycerol can be for you as a family that I don't really have to mention as much, right? Because you understand what is it. So basically, it's a three carbon material consisting of three different OH group or RCA group. Okay, at three different ends of the carbon. Okay, one carbon, two carbon, three carbon. There are three carbon, and one carbon will have OH group. Okay, which is actually the function group for this particular material. And because of the three functional existing in the material, we have different opportunities. Okay? And of course, the colorless liquid, okay, from the appearance, is colorless, but 1.290 So the point is quite high actually, okay, for you to really separate this material from the lithium. Of course, we need to be careful because. The boiling point is 290, but at the same time, at that particular temperature, we start to become over it. And it's very viscous. It's very viscous, so we have problem with that. Okay, in many types of industry, we have a lot of problem with that because of the high viscosity of the substance. Okay, so some general information about the properties of the glycerol. So for us to really understand what it is. Of course, for me, I believe you can understand it well, because I think many of you, or all although nuclear chemists or chemical background, my training, so definitely I don't really have to really discuss too much. Right. So what's the plan? What's the concern for nowadays? So the concern is the overproduction. I mentioned earlier overproduction of rice crop, and it is actually a great concern to oil company industry in Malaysia, in Indonesia, in many other oil producing countries in the world. Because we are producing what we want, but at the same time, we also produce rice crop at a rate far beyond the demand in the market. So that is a concern. And maybe we can break it down into several different types of industry that can actually produce rice crop. Biodiesel industry is the main contributor nowadays, okay. But maybe you know what it is. Biodiesel is a fatty acid metabolizer and it is actually a fuel for future. It seems to be the most potential replacement to diesel, okay, petroleum diesel in the future. And fatty acid industry is currently, back in 2009, it contributed 71%, and it's actually going down. Instead, currently biodiesel is the number one producer of cholesterol in the market, so industry of alcohol, synthesis production, and others. So these two are currently the main production, the main producer of cholesterol in the market. You can see here a shift from oil-chemical to biodiesel, because currently the focus of the people is given too much on the future fuel, alternative fuel, to replace the rotating petrochemical diesel. Sometimes in 10 years for biodiesel derived glycerol, you can see there's a lot of increase from biodiesel industry as compared to the earlier sales in 1999. 2009 onward, no longer synthetically produced. Maybe last time, yes, it was produced synthetically, okay, because of the synthetic chemistry and also contributed to the production of glycerol. But of course, after 2009 onward, no more production. Synthetic production of glycerol, because it's readily abundantly available from these, especially these two types of industry. Okay? So that is the scenario nowadays. Before we move on to more and more chemistry, so we need to really understand the scenario and also the problem, the concern, the economic concern in our countries first. Right. So in biodiesel industry, for example, is actually produced through a process, chemical process known as trans centrifugation, and we use vegetable oil. Okay, in our case, or sometimes we can use an animal oil. Of course, this is the main starting material for us to use for the production of biodiesel. Another one is methanol. Of course, we need to use catalyst to provide a system with suitable conditions for it to occur. Significantly, and we are producing biodiesel or methanolizer, and this is the one. Okay, my concern here is the crude rice is produced. Okay, so this is what you want. So this is the desired product. Okay, no problem with that. No issue. We are happy that we are getting this, but at the same time, this is also produced. Okay, biodiesel is actually methanolizer, and along the way, we are also producing like diglycerol, monoglycerol. And finally, we end up with glycerol, okay, as the ultimate product from this particular combination. Glycerol is the product of biodiesel industry, and 10% of biodiesel amount is actually glycerol. So if you want to know how much we produce glycerol from biodiesel industry, it is about 10%. Okay, just take that round estimation. 10% of the biodiesel is actually glycerol. Okay, 1 ton of biodiesel is produced. 100 kg is actually biodiesel. So meaning to say that the amount is really, really significant. Okay. And of course, from the vegetable production, we cannot really get a pure, highly purified biodiesel. Of course, there's a lot of impurities, a lot of intermediates out there, still there. And of course, the purification process is quite complicated and also expensive. Any further into the cost of the operation. So, some conclusion can be made here from this particular side. Impurities present in crude rice crop. Purification process is very expensive. Purification is now not economically viable. Okay, now people are talking about purification is the no-go. We should not go for the purification because of the cost incurred in the purification process. Okay, now the idea here is that we produce a significant amount of rice crop, but people don't want to purify. Meaning to say that cooked rice salt is simply considered as waste. The amount is very, very a lot. It's a lot in the market. It's a lot in the market, but at the same time, the demand in the industry is actually not really there so much. But we are producing. We are producing. What to do with it? Because it's available. It's there, sitting there in the medicinal industry or medicinal release. So what to do with it? Because in the end, space will be constrained, and sooner or later, we have to dispose it. And how to do with it? How to deal with it? Right? That's the question. Right, so we can see here estimated production of food glycerol will be increasing from year to year, from estimated to be very, very high, 30 billion pounds per year, and these are the contributors. Malaysia is there, Indonesia is also there, Colombia, India, China, there are many different countries are currently producing glycerol. Crude glycerol is not yet to be crude, but it is crude, right? There is a lot of impurities there. Rising increase in biodiesel production, we can see the trend here. EU, USA, Brazil, Indonesia, Malaysia are the main contributor to the production of glycerol in the market, projected to increase until 2020. Demand doesn't increase corresponding to that situation. Or that is the concern. Right? We produce, but people don't need it. Okay? Glycerol plant in the market. This is the current scenario. Right? And you can see what happened. The correlation between the price of the production rate from 2004 to 2006, okay, this is just one statistic that I got. Maybe, yeah, of course it's not the latest, but we can see the trend, right? Increasing in terms of the amount produced, but increasing very sharp decrease in terms of the price. So this is what happened. We produce a lot, but in the end it's becoming cheaper and cheaper. And to the extent that it has no value. So it seems now to be something recent, something undesirable, something a waste, right? Because it has a waste in this particular type of industry. And because of that, it's important, but actually it has a lot of opportunity. I'll be sharing this later. Drastic increase in mining production, oversupply glycerol in the market, a plunge in glycerol price, considered as a waste. Currently it's now considered as a waste, with zero or negative price tag. Zero means no value at all. Negative means you have to spend to get rid of it. So it is too bad. Knowing the potential that this particular substance can actually provide, okay, for us, for you as a chemist, so definitely you can see a lot of potential knowing the structure of the molecule. Okay, cost for glycerol before disposal is a concern, and it's not that easy for us to really get rid of it. And you can see the potential of why I see this as a very important issue for us, for our economy, which is highly dependent on the production of biodiesel, the production of polychemical, and also palm oil. You can see here, crude glycerol selling price, if it can increase, okay, the price can be increased by a certain way or certain method, whether policy or be technical as one. We can actually getting better and better offset to the production cost. So it has a lot of potential here in terms of the offsetting the production cost. Okay? Because we are selling something which is more and more expensive, because that is we are getting some financial return out of it, and that we can get some degree or some level of offset to the production cost. So this is what we expect or what can be promised, okay, if we manage to increase the value of biodiesel. Okay, crude glycerol selling price has a direct impact on process economy. This is one of the conclusions we can make out of this particular figure. Higher selling price could upset production costs. New demand for glycerol should be created. Okay, this is the topic that I'll be discussing with you later. Okay, with a very limited time available, I'll be discussing some information or some topics regarding the new demand for glycerol in the future. Pushing for development of a new value-added products. We are talking about product from glycerol. Of course, glycerol we cannot do much about it, but of course we can consider this as a starting material for production of many different chemicals. Right? You can see potential here. The new outlet of glycerol, you can see glycerol can be applicable or very useful. It can be industry, commercial chemical, pharmaceutical, oral care, food, livestock feed, energy, bioenergy, miscellaneous, so on and so forth. So definitely there's a lot of uses. Basically these are established, but of course the demand could not be that much as compared to the production rate. Okay? We can see more use here, 3 carbon, 3 OH. Okay? OH, definitely we know that the OH group is a very marginal group, and it is actually a very important thing, very correction interaction with many other molecules. We have seen, okay, in very recent years, we have seen a lot of application, okay, in industry, and also people keep on developing new applications for cholesterol or new types of chemicals from cholesterol. And usually, currently, the need is very small quantities and go up with the production rate. So this is the concern currently with the cholesterol, and we have to do something on it to solve the problem and at the same time to get some financial return out of it. Okay? So people, last time, very recently, people consider this cholesterol as a waste, so they need to really get rid of it. So what they do is to burn it. Okay, so to the combustion. But of course, this is not that simple because, of course, the capital investment needs to be there, the operating investment, if operating budget or operating cost will be there. And at the same time, you need to consider that cholesterol has good energy density, it actually burns that easily, it has a high viscosity so that you can have a problem with some equipment and so on. And high operation temperature, it is actually not combustible readily, so that you need to have high temperature to start the combustion process, and high temperature always mean high operating cost. Submicron 5H, okay, of course we can understand that we can have some problem with the health. And also the production of acrolein, this is very very important substance coming up from the combustion of lysol. Acrolein is known to be toxic to human, to animal, and at the same time it could be affecting the health of the people, especially workers working in this type of industry. So we are having a problem of acrolein production, okay, in the combustion of lysol. So we have our lysol to get rid of it is very costly, and at the same time it's very problematic to the environment. Okay, what to do today? So now we need to really see the potential of lysol. Okay, no major changes in about 10 years, in the last 10 years, the major bio-combustion uses in major applications as fuel additive. Okay, some people use lysol to produce fuel additive, some to produce other materials or substances that we'll be discussing on later. But of course, the major changes is actually not occurring in the last 10 years. So now, for the researcher, definitely, we need to really think about how to convert this particular or this beautiful substance into some very really chemical, so that in the end it can bring the functional reason to the nation, and at the same time it can also solve environmental problem. Okay. Right. Chemically, lysol can be used to get different value-added products. Maybe you can see here by chemical parts. By chemical part, we can get some, maybe for those of you who are actually focusing on this, you can consider what to do with it, definitely. Cyclization, dehydration, esterification, eterification, oligomerization, reduction, reforming, they are all chemical processes. I believe many of you here are organic chemists, so definitely know what these terms are. Definitely, but different processes will give you different type of product, and they are important in their own way, okay? In their own way, because there's a lot of demand for this type of material. But now, actually, the demand for this is actually very, very low, very, very poor. So our challenge, or the challenge here, is to get rid of this by creating some route to produce some value-added chemicals. So that is the idea that I want to really focus here. For example, isobutylene. As a subset of one of the reactants, we can use to carry out the esterification process to produce dye, tertiary butyl, glycerol ether, dye, tertiary butyl, glycerol ether, and so on. they are very useful as additive, okay, full additive, right, to improve the optimals, obtain number of the field. Acetic acid can be used through acetylation, or some people use acetylization. You can get diacetylthiazole. This is also improved. It is also useful to improve the cold viscosity properties of the fuels. Lysol, deterioration, you can get polyglycol, you can have some useful products out of that. And also acetylation reaction through acetylation. We can get acetyl glycerol, triacetyl glycerol, and so on. There are actually many different products possible from glycerol, so that it is actually having a lot of potential for us to use. So now the concern is, yeah, of course, the idea of the ultimate goal, you know, so we have to convert glycerol into some other chemicals, but now what are the concerns? So we need to have a fast process, improved process, clean, sedative process, less waste, less energy, less toxin, less expensive, higher yield, higher purity, safer process, and high profitability. Those are actually concerns in industry. So maybe for some of you who really focus on chemistry, maybe these terms are not that much there, or that not that much of your concern. But for us, okay, focusing on chemical technology, chemical engineering, usually we are concerning on this equally. Okay, some important aspects for us to really consider before we can see or we can say, we can claim that the process is successfully conducted or not. Right. So, this is the topic. The conclusion, you know that we have to convert the guys to some product, but now the concern is what are the catalysts. So, my area is actually catalysis. My area of research is catalysis. So, we have different types of catalysts, very porous material, high specific material, but at the same time, several other materials and so on. So definitely there's a lot of concern, a lot of discussion on heterogeneous catalysts, but to be consistent with the theme of the conference here, so I'll be discussing some information about the catalysts. So we have to reproduce some type of catalysts. And these are the requirements. We have to make sure that the catalysts are active. Catalysts are active. Very selective, we are making the desired product out of the condition that we get, or we do. Modifiable, we can modify for a certain requirement. Shape selectivity, okay, we are getting some desired product. And of course the pore size needs to be of a suitable size, right? Some of you, maybe you have some background on catalysis or catalytic processes, so you should know that pore size is playing very, very critical role in some formation. We use the wrong type of catalytic, we need the wrong type or wrong size or pore size, definitely we unable to get the desired product. Maybe we are getting some undesired product and we are having problems with the product separation later. Pore size distribution is another concern. It must be stable, easy separation from the reaction mixer after the process, because heterogeneous catalyst is actually meant to be recycled and reused after that. It's not really one time use, and after that we just dispose it or we neutralize and dispose, because that creates some problematic issues with the environment later. And it needs to be a clean process if you are not reproducing something undesirable and something toxic. Reusability is also another concern. Safer process, of course everything should be safe, because chemical conversion, even though you can get it, you can successfully conduct the process, but unfortunately if the system or the process is very, very harmful, very, very hazardous, very, very unsafe to the people, definitely we shouldn't do that, because of course the safety is always the priority in industry. And higher profitability, meaning you are getting the desired product with the desired purity and at the same time the desired heat. Okay. So the concern is on heterogeneous catalyst. We have to really design the right type of catalyst for our condition. And I'll be focusing on three different reactions that are actually involved in my research group, or in our research group in Science Malaysia. So first one is glycerol to monoglyceride. Monoglyceride is used as emulsifier or surfactant in cosmetic, food, pharmaceutical products and all, and so on. There are many demands for monoglyceride. So basically, it involves a reaction between glycerol and fatty acid with the presence of acid catalase, with the presence of the heating elements here, and we are getting different products. That is the concern. In catalytic processes, always we are getting different products, and we are talking about only one design product out of these three. We have monoglyceride, diglyceride, and triglyceride. Of course, we can already control the occurrence or the cause of the depression using homogeneous catalyst. We have to go for a heterogeneous catalyst because we are actually aiming for this. We want monoglyceride, we don't want di and tri, because monoglyceride is very useful, di, tri are not very much useful. Right? So we have to go for this, and how to control the depression? That is important because the depression can simply continue. We have 1, 2, 3 H group over here for the depression with the fatty acid. Any group will have interaction with the fatty acid to give acid. But the problem is we want only here or here, which are more glyceride. So we don't want further acidification to form 2 glyceride over here. 2 ester branch, or this one is 3 ester branch for all the 3 OH group. So we want the product, we want the reaction to be fast, but at the same time we want the desired product. We don't want this. Okay, we don't want these 2 different products. So we are actually for here we need to develop a catalyst which is very selective, so that we get most of the time we get monoglyceride. But it can suppress the formation of dark and also tri. So we are having 2 challenges here. One is to get high rate of reaction. Another one is we want to control the occurrence of products so that only desired product or mostly desired products are formed in our competition. Right. So in our research group, we use porous material. Of course, this particular type of material actually developed through our research work, and also we are actually using some other material already established and already reported by the chemists. So we functionalizing with some materials so that now we are using acid sites over here so that the material now is turned acidic, so that now we can get the reaction to occur at the highest rate possible. And we also try layered material with the intervention spacing here. And this is occupied by some ions, and this create acidity in the material. So now the concern here is we need to have a suitable pore size. We can actually manipulate the system, manipulate the material so that we can have the desired size. Okay? Narrow PSD means pore size distribution, alright? Because in heterogeneous catalysis, we can get pore spectrum, but that doesn't mean that you have a very regular or very narrow pore size distribution, which is very critical for a successful competition. Because narrow pore size distribution means we can get the desired product most of the time, and we can suppress the formation of undesired product. Okay, this is the challenge, but usually it is not really achievable 100%. High solubility, of course, there are separate catalysts. We rely very much on the surface size for the formation, and the method is to have high solubility surface area. So this is one of the important elements for catalysis. The material needs to have high surface area, and we can functionalize it with some functional group. Okay, here is a substrate group. We also functionalize it in the. Salted zirconia, we specialize with some other super acids so that acid sites are created. But of course, acid sites are not everything. So we have to really make use of the unique pore size or distribution or system of the material to get the desired condition out of the process. Okay, strip channels, for here is the strip channels, consists of 80s of strip channels. Must be stable. Okay, this is another concern. The material needs to be stable because at the end of the process, the material needs to be recovered and reused in the next cycle of the process. And changeable pore size is also another concern. First, we will decide which material is most potential for this particular type of condition. Okay, for example, here we can see we have done some work on the effect of transmission. Effect of the catalyst loading, and we can see here most of the time we are getting monoglyceride. Definitely we are unable to suppress the formation of dye and tri. Understand? They are there, still there. But of course, we get the desired product, okay, at the highest percentage, so this is something desirable. And effect of kinesiology, you can see that still monoplasia is the one. Okay, monoplasia is the dominant product. Okay, it's not dominant product from the conversion. Because consider the patient who are multiple conversion, so definitely it will be good if we can get the desired product out of the conversion. Okay, next process is lyophilized form. How many more is that? 5 minutes, okay, I'm right, almost there. Okay, next process is lyophilized form. It is actually a process involving condition of a glycerol upon reaction with another molecule of glycerol to produce high glycerol, and the process can actually proceed further into the formation of triglycerol and polyglycerol. So, but of course, our products here, the product of concern is actually the diglycerol. Di and triglycerol can be used as oxidative food additive, modern liquid ink and humectant. So this is particularly most useful, and of course, triglycerol sometimes can be used as well. Because now we can get rid of this 100%. So these two are actually useful products, but we want the further occurrence or further condensation reaction to polyglycerol. So now we want to get the conversion, we want the reaction to be fast, but at the same time we want to stop it somewhere. So that is the challenge, okay? That is the challenge, but that can be addressed by use of a certain superthermal material as catalyst. And also we can produce a different type of isomer here, because we have three carbons over here. Any one of these carbons can have deep reaction with another molecule of glycerol, so definitely the shape selectivity effect in the condition will be there, and because of that we have to use the right type of material as catalyst. And if last time we could use homogeneous catalyst for this starting type of conversion, of course it could be good, but at the same time we can have very poor selectivity. Okay, very poor selectivity, we are not making the right product. But at the same time, homogeneous catalysts are actually not useful. So we use it for only once, and after that we just dispose it. We just treat it, we separate from the reducer, and because that is a waste. Because if we can use it for another cycle of the reaction, that will be useful because we can save cost in the conversion. Diglycerol, we can see here some results to be shared. We use different types of material of homogeneous. We compare with the homogeneous lithium hydroxide. But of course, we use two different types of porous catalysts. Okay, for this result, we use clay. And after we modify with the lithium and we see what will happen. Okay, the condition is very high, and also at the same time the condition or selectivity to diglycerol is also high. Right. So these are the different molecules that are possible from this conversion. You can see here there's the result. We can have three different peaks for diglycerol, meaning to say that we have three different isomers of it. So definitely some shape selectivity effect occur. During the process, you can see the difference from homogeneous to K-material, but this is heterogeneous or solid catalyst. You can see the peak here, alpha alpha is high, this one alpha alpha is actually lower as compared to the earlier one of alpha beta. You can see alpha alpha and alpha beta. So in a way, we can say that with the use of right type of method, we can actually manipulate, we can actually control the process so that we are getting the desired product. Okay, another result, of course, maybe I will just skip this particular one. Go for the next one, which is the last process, which is lactic acid. Okay, the glycerol formation with the presence of OH or another alkaline condition, the presence of the right type of catalyst, we can direct direction towards the formation of lactic acid. But of course, we should be happy with that if we produce lactic acid, because we are also producing at the same time glycerolic acid, tartaric acid, glycolic acid, formic acid. There are many more acids that are being produced at the same time, but we only need this. We only need the first, but we want the rest. So that is the challenge. Right? That is the challenge, and that can be addressed by the use of red alpha material, red alpha catalyst, or porous catalyst. Here, glycerol formation will be the first formation will be through a certain intermediate, and of course, some changes in the form of it, in the molecule of it, will occur during the process. But this is favorable. Okay, this is lactic acid, but this is unfavorable, which is glycerolic acid. So we have to use the right type of material, right type of catalyst for this particular type of formation. For this particular case, we use 1% lithium over carbon. And we provide it further with a 0.34 weight of copper. So copper is used to improve the quality or the performance of this material in the sense that it will lead to the reaction to form lactic acid rather than classic acid. Because if we use the wrong type of material, this will be formed and this is undesirable. Okay, in this conversion. Right, there is some results here. The conversion is done at the temperature of 90°C, which is quite mild. Okay, 0.1 megapascal, then time of 4 hours, and the ratio of lithium hydroxide to glycerol of 1.5. You are getting about 750 to lactic acid with the right kind of catalyst, of course. And this two lactic, and also the other one is glycerolic acid, the predominant products from the conversion. So we want to suppress the formation of this and also the rest. We want to get most of the time, we want to get the lactic acid. But it's quite challenging. But at the same time, it's very interesting topic for us to reconsider as a chemist, as a chemical engineer working on catalysis, because we can use with the interpretation of the right type of material, the right type of right reaction conditions, we can get the desired product out of the composition from glycerol. Right, so that's the idea, and this is some results over here. That AC is the predominant product. We can get very high completion in very short time, for about 5 hours. Not that short, but still relatively short. Okay, considering the typical reaction occurring. At the same time, we are confronting with the completion of restaurant to some undesired products. So complete completion is 6 hours. And the AC is the main product, stable, and sensitivity of other product is suppressed to the lower than 25%. Based on conclusion that can be drawn from this presentation, our supply glass wall production causes a glass in the market. It is now very expensive. Okay, I mentioned it earlier, it is now very expensive to get rid of. Can be converted actually to value added products to improve the overall sustainability of the industry. Now we are dealing with the ideal heterogeneous catalytic material. Okay. The material is becoming defined so that we can get the right conversion, the right product out of the conversion. And for that reason, definitely we, of course, I would like to highlight that the needs for us to be further investigate into this topic so that in the end we are getting the products out of glycerol, which is currently seen as a problematic substance in the oil palm industry. Okay, I think with that I will end my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.
We will have about 15 minutes for discussion. And for the start, we are going to open for 3 questions. If you have any question, please introduce yourself and to whom your question is addressed. 1, 2, and 3. Okay, first.
Thank you. My name is Hartanti from Satyawacana Christian University. My question is to Professor Ahmad Sihayati.
Okay. Thank you for the interesting presentation. I have a simple question, Professor. I start work with plant oil, but not palm oil. Usually, I obtain glycerol as a side product of saponification. According to your experience, is it necessary to purify the crude oil before enter saponification process? Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Usman Somopulan Tamnan from University of Indonesia. Already my present to Prof. Hasan, my colleagues from India. Instead of using enzyme as a biocatalyst, have you ever used antibody to get an asymmetric compound? And the second one to my colleague from University of Indonesia, Prof. Ahmad. In discussion of glycerol, you mentioned already glycerol outlet of production. In case of using that one, you told me that you can use that glycerol in bioethanology feed to produce omega 3. Okay? Can you explain about that one? Because omega 3 is a big one. Glycerol it has only 3 C atoms, but in case of discussing omega 3, at least probably more than 15 carbon atoms. Can you explain about that one? Thank you so much. Yeah.
I will start with the antibody question. Then I come to the use of antibody is acceptable, provided that antibody, which usually is the case, bind when enantiomer more than the other. Then the idea is basically depending on the binding constant, different between the two, where you can then separate and recover. In my opinion, the antibodies will face two disadvantages. These antibodies are heat sensitive. So while the radiation will come, while the radiation especially become quite favorable, that you can, radiation can work in an organic solvent like toluene, which is unusual for enzymes. You can heat up to 60 degrees the medium, and you don't lose much of the activity of the radiation. See, so for this two reasons, radiation became popular. Furthermore, being cheap. Okay, yes.
Do you agree with me that antibody is also biocatalyst?
Yeah. Antibodies can be used, but the application of it will be kind of impractical. Sorry, why? Because you have an antibody, then you have the two in it. They will bind to the antibody one way or another through interactive forces, hydrogen bonding, by interaction, dipole-dipole interaction, whatever. But there will be difference between this interactive force binding to that antibody. Okay, then one bind fixes more than the other. You have to separate. Actually, you have to separate using, for example, chromatography, HPLC, in most of the cases. Then you have to recover back. Already you have a complex antibody plus antibody one, for example. Then you need to separate that antibody in order to recover the result. So, but in the case of the enzyme, that is not a problem, because worst case scenario, you can actually immobilize your design on a support, then use it, hit your compound, and if you have a magnetic particle like that, Fe3O4, all right, and make a nanoparticle, you can, and you immobilize that by things on that nanoparticle, she present nanoparticle, for example. Then you carry out the reaction, and with a small magnet, you put the magnet, all the iron nanoparticle will be attracted, leaving a supernatant with your compound with it. So, the idea of what I want to emphasize, the idea of using an antibody is super, I mean, scientifically beautiful. But when you start applying it, you will feel, you will start facing some problems. And one of it is being the sensitivity, the cellular sensitivity of the antibodies. You have to isolate the antibodies and make sure it's pure enough, no impurity in it, otherwise it will start interfering. While the lipase, you get the lipase in a high purity.
It is a protein also, right?
Do you want
that? It is a protein also.
It is protein, yes.
The
lipase also is a protein.
What is the difference?
The difference. Okay, the nature of the lipase is being a thermostable up to 60 degrees. I want you to go to the literature and look for any enzyme which reaches 60 and retain activity. Count on one finger. Not much. Not much. Okay? Other thing, you can carry the reaction in organic form. It doesn't have to be aqueous. 95% of the enzyme we know, it has to be aqueous medium. So that is the beauty of the lipids. In case of the antibody, yes.
You can absorb the antibody of the membrane and then give the visible on it. Catch one
thing
in the other, and
then
it's like
simulating moving there, for example. Okay, but it's not going to be, practically, the purity will be an issue. The purity will be an issue. All right, or you're going to cut me out? All right, as far as the question, answering how to choose the separation. No, here is the thing. First of all, I want to see the audience that the racemic mixture, as we know, is a 50-50% of the two ingredients. And in most of the cases, one usually is more active than the other, or the other one is causing serious side effects and so on. Once this is established, you have options. You have the option. Of course, if you tell me how you proceed with, I say, carry out the separation first using chromatography. Because you're going to need it sooner or later. So establish the chromatographic condition to separate the two enantiomer nicely. Then, now you need quantity. In case what you need quantity, the lipase will be the issue. Because cost-wise, it is cheaper. And all what you need, and that after you finish your lot of separation in the lipase, you have to give an evidence for the purity of the product. So you go back to chromatography in order to make sure it's a 99.9% pure, that there is, and the enantiomeric excess is almost to the minimum. So the purity of the enantiomer is satisfied. Okay?
Can I just be sitting here while answer your question. So I'm a bit tired. We had some rest earlier, so I just completed my presentation just now, and I reached here quite late last night. So I received two questions from the floor. One is on the use of different type of oil. It's not palm oil, but different type of oil. I believe it's been, you use it for biodiesel production, formation of FS metal ester through a conversion using NaOH or some other alkali as a catalyst. And you notice some degree of superformation or superification reaction occur significantly. So this is very, very common problem actually with many type of oil, because it contains significant amount of free fatty acids. Instead of we are getting trans acidification reaction as usually we expect in the formation of biodiesel, we get superification, okay, the reaction between the alkali materials or NaOH, for example, in this particular case, with the fatty acid instead of triglyceride, right? Oil is triglyceride, but presenting a certain amount, significant amount of fatty acid. Fatty acid will consume the catalyst, right? So that is too bad, right? Because we expect the catalyst to remain in the system, but in this particular case, catalyst is consumed. So we are getting less catalyst at the end of the day, at the end of the process, because certain amount of it is converted into salt, okay? Metal salt of fatty acid. Okay, so usually this is what to expect in the feedstock containing significant amount of fatty acid. So the question here is whether we have to really go for separation or purification first. I believe that is one option for us to really go forward, meaning we will separate the fatty acid from the triglyceride, then we can get some good trans acidification reaction, right? Because there is no for the significant presence of fatty acid in the feedstock that has been purified. So that is one option. Another option could be a two-step process, meaning we usually carry out the acidification process first, followed by trans acidification process. Meaning two-step process is actually another option for us to go for. Another consideration that maybe is yet to be fully successful, but some people try to make an attempt into it. People use two different types of active sites in the catalyst. So they use what they call as bifunctional acid and also base present in the material at the same time. So acid can take care of the conversion of free fatty acid to ester, okay, metal ester, free fatty acid is there, but you have to remove it. But the catalyst contains significant amount of acidic, so that acidic can play a role, okay, in catalyzing the reaction, so that fatty acid can react with the methanol to produce metal ester. That is one thing. Another side, the type of side in the material is basic sides. Basic sides can catalyze much faster trans acidification reaction, okay, to result in the formation of the same material, which is metal ester, okay? Metal ester. So there are three options. One is to purify, right? Another one is to go for the two-step conversion. Another approach, of course, is open for further research. Definitely the success is not really there yet. But of course, I'm also involved in some related work in that some degree of success is actually seen, but of course it's not 100% successful. So what we do is we introduce two different types of functional group or active sites into the catalyst material, basic and acid site present together. So one take care of one component of the oil. Okay, fatty acid is actually handled by the acid site. Glyceride, okay, triglyceride is actually handled by the pesticide. So three different options that can be considered. Okay, so that is my response to question number one. Question number two, you mentioned about biotechnology, right? The use of glycerol to produce omega-3, okay, which is a very hot topic nowadays. It's top obesity. So many people talk about omega-3 because of the concern on health. Of course, it is good if we can consume it. Because that can be used to improve the quality of life or health quality. But of course, that is easily applicable to the discussion on the fatty acid. So here we are focusing on glycerol rather than fatty acid. But of course, omega 3 is useful because it is polyunsaturated. It has three unsaturation. For example, linoleic acid or polylinoleic acid, which is very known to be a component of omega 3. And of course, our body can easily handle unsaturated fatty acid very well. That is the thing actually to be considered, because if we go for the unsaturated fatty acid, the body can consume, the body can break it into some smaller molecules. While if we go for saturated fatty acids, okay, usually derived from animal fats and so on, so usually our body will have very limited capability to deal with them, and the body even didn't know what to do with it. So this glycerol we present in the bloodstream and it causes some problem related to the health or heart disease or something like that. Of course, I should not be commenting too much on that because I'm not really expert in the medical areas, but the concern or the focus, the discussion on the alpha omega 3 is very, very interesting, but of course, it is not really applicable to glycerol, because to convert glycerol into combine the molecules into the formation of polyunsaturated fatty acid, we require a lot of different processes, I believe. Right. Usually we go for the type of fatty acid, the right type of fatty acid to really get that kind of benefit, rather than to put our effort to convert glycerol into fatty acid, which is very, very difficult. I believe it requires a lot of step processes and on. It will be very, very complicated, but it should not be actually, it's not really advisable focus of your research. But of course, you can focus on some other very other products from the glycerol. Thank you.
Now we are going to open for the next session. If there are any questions? One. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. So, my name is Marziza Madina, and I'm from Islamic University of Indonesia. And I would like to give a question to Professor Dr. Ahmad. So, I have read about thesis according to your topic, but glycerol can be used as a one of permanent food called dust suppressant, and without purification and with easy way. So, can you give me the main reason why we have to choose glycerol to use as a platform for chemical synthesis is from the price? Thank you very much.
That is oxygen rights atom. and side product is water. As we know, water is the activity from catalyze chopper 1 and chopper 2. Why? How to remove water from this reaction? Thank you very much.
My name is Batama from Voluntary Intensive Experience. My question is a testing to Professor Amatieri, testing physician. In addition to use crystal as a cutting material to produce many various chemicals, I think, however, the very important process is separate the crystal produced during hydrolysis reaction from fat to be ethyl and fatty acid. So the first question is how to separate the crystal through the very effective procedure. And the second question is, in addition to the using crystal to be converted to many various organic chemicals, I have other opinion to produce more of this crystalline without catalyst. Because to synthesize catalyst is not easy, right? I propose that the first step is two ingredients should be blocked by using carbonyl compound. And after that, we have three blocks. This one can be perfect to monoxide by using fatty acid, just by using
processes or transit industries,
polychemical industries, biogenic industries, so these industries are currently producing plasma. So now we are talking about what we have. We are talking about something that can be readily available in our land, right? Rather than focusing on something that is available in some other countries in Europe, in Africa, and so on. Better focus on what we have, because it is actually the material or the substance that we produce from our industry is actually available in our land, and it is actually problematic to the environment, to the people, to the industry. So we need to really find the solution, the best solution to really solve, to really address all the concerns related to livestock. So that is the concern, that is actually the reason, the rationale why we go for livestock formation. Because it's available, it's very cheap. We produce glycerol, we don't really use it. So now, why don't we just focus on the research work that can, in the end, hopefully one day something could coming out from it. We produce another type of industry. We can actually produce another type of substance. We can create some type of industry in our own land that, in the end, can use glycerol as a feedstock to produce something like chemicals, so that downstream industry can be generated, we can improve the employment of to the people, at the same time we can utilize what we have to produce something that it can contribute to our economy. So those are the rationale behind glycerol, because it's very key things in glycerol in the oil chemical industry, in the biogenic industry nowadays, because we are getting the product, which are fatty acid, which are actually fatty acid metal ester, biodiesel. We are getting those products, no problem with that, but yes, one product remain unsolved, which is glycerol, which is something that provides us with a lot of opportunity, a lot of potential, a lot of interesting future for our economy. So I believe that is something that is a need for us, right? As for those who are educated in chemistry, in chemical technology, chemical engineering, you think they are, we understand the problem, we can really see the potential of it. So why not we just do some research to find a solution to it, so that in the end, hopefully one day the problem can be solved as a whole rather than transferring one problem to another problem. Okay, that is my response to the first question. The second question is diglycerol, right? Glycerol plus glycerol to form diglycerol. And of course the reaction doesn't really stop that, it can further continue. In the presence of the active catalyst, in the presence of suitable reaction condition, the process can continue. But the concern here, we want to stop that, hopefully. We want to stop that. Of course, naturally, the reaction won't favor the formation of triglycerol and all that, because those are large molecules, naturally. But of course, we try to stop the reaction as much as possible at the stage of diglycerol, so that we can get this product most of the time, and so it should be the main product coming out from this particular process. That is the objective of it, right? That is the reason why we need to really do some research on the catalytic material for us to really get high rate of reaction, but at the same time high selectivity for the formation of diglycerol, because we want to stop the reaction. We want to stop. It's not that easy. The reaction, the catalyst is good, the reaction can proceed. So we want to stop it somewhere, so it's not easy. Because it will naturally continue to the next accelerator or intermediation step. So this is the concern, but of course, that is the challenge for those who are working in this area to really find the right type of material, right type of condition for us to carry out the reaction, so that we can get glycerol, okay, as a predominant product. And water is produced, okay? The water is produced in the reaction. Of course, water, this reaction is actually a reversible reaction, so it can reverse, it can move forward, it can reverse backward. In the presence of water, water will actually promote, excess amount of water will promote the reverse reaction. So we have to really find way to remove, okay? We have to really find way to remove water from the system. Luckily, the reaction is usually carried out at ambient pressure or 1 atm, so that it's not that difficult for us to remove the water, okay, generated from the reaction. In water, is definitely is a co-product, it will be generated in the reaction in the process, but of course it should be continuously removed so that it can promote the for aggression through the formation of megaglycerides. Or otherwise, upon the presence of significant amount of water in the aggression mixture, reverse aggression can occur significantly instead of the forward aggression. In the end, we are getting back the starting material. So what's the point? So water needs to be removed, and the aggression condition is actually at only one ATM. So it's easy, rather easy for us. The process can be carried out continuously, and water can be removed continuously from the aggression mixture. Okay, that is my response to question number two. Another question. Number three, we have glycerol to very chemical. And of course, the separation. Okay, separation of glycerol, purification of glycerol is one of the important topic. And of course, nowadays, I think people really claim that the only best solution for the purification of glycerol is to use molecular distillation. Is we need to have very specialized equipment, very expensive, and we need to run the process in a very controlled, we need a control manner so that we can get the separation of this molecule from the fatty acid, the molecule of fatty acid that will present in the aggression mixture, and we are getting highest possible glycerol out of the process. So it is actually something achievable, something proven actually. But of course, when it comes to the cost consideration, people are not really going towards that. So that is the idea in my presentation I mentioned to you earlier. We have to really find the value, we have to create value, we have to value add glycerol so that when the product is very valuable, the cost for the purification will be justified. Currently, it's not justified because we have to do a very expensive process to purify glycerol. In the end, the purified glycerol is just sold at a very low price. So what's the point? So we are not really getting the return out of our investment, out of our effort, because in the end the final product is rather cheap. So why not we just create something very added glycerol so that the final product will be very expensive, very, very high demand in the market, so that the cost of the purification is justified. So currently the available technology is molecular distillation, but of course if you want to venture into this type of system, you can always try a different type of processor. Maybe chromatography process can be cancel the purpose as well. No, but of course currently available, or the most feasible, the most feasible method is molecular distillation, but still expensive, still not to be justified. On the purification of glycerol. Number one is just now the question was on glycerol plus fatty acid to produce monoglyceride. If I can understand it correctly, we have another alternative for the process. We can go for other type of reaction, for example, trans-esterification from triglyceride in fatty acid to produce monoglyceride. That is also possible, but we usually go for esterification because we want to have a very controlled reaction so that we can get the desired product, okay, in our product itself. So this is very critical, this is very important, because I mentioned to you earlier, glycerol has three different thresholds. Any three, any one of these three, or any two of these two, even all of them can interact or can have interaction with the fatty acid, and it can form different molecules. So what we want is a smaller glycerol because of the price of it, which is very expensive and which is very high demand in the market, rather than diglycerol. So the idea here is that we want to have a controlled reaction process so that we can get the desired reaction products, so that we can control the system, we can actually suppress information of undesired products, which are diglyceride and triglyceride from the aggression mixture by the use of a certain suitable type of catalyst with a suitable property, suitable characteristic, so that we can get the most successful combustion from this particular multiple step reaction. Right? Because usually for multiple step reaction is very difficult. Right? The process, the reaction can occur in any way, any possible way.
So we mentioned we prolong the reaction time, it can lead to some other undesired product. Even though we the desired product already for earlier, but you lengthen the time, you give you some undesired product because the product can also undergo reaction. Bear that in mind. And reverse reaction can also be possible if the formation of the product is actually significant after some time, then significant reverse reaction can also occur because sometimes we are going back to the original place, meaning we are not really getting the product, instead we are converting the product but again come back to the method. Okay, so what's the point? You know, okay, we are not really getting the desired product. So those are my responses to different questions that I can give. Thank you very much.
We still have time for two more questions from the audience. Any more questions? One, two.
Me again, sorry. My question is the same to Professor Hassan about chromatography. As we know that the past is produced by our digestion organ, pancreas, right? So everything that in our body, so maybe will be digested by us. So can the passer also work perfectly without immobilize or become solid chromatography to spread the chiral molecule?
But repulsor, you know, repulsor is enzyme produced by pancreas. Pancreas, right?
Excuse me, can you talk to the speaker, please? So everyone can hear what you're talking about. Is that the right?
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name is Galih Senapati from LIPI. I want to ask to Professor Nigarwani about ceramic polymer composite. The first one is, can you explain the process of making of ceramic polymer composite? As I know, the process of composite is there's a process of mixing and forming into shape. Can you explain the details? And the second is the application of these biomaterials, the specific application, because the different part of bone is have different mechanical properties. Okay, and then the last one is this biomaterial is for permanent or non-permanent application for bone replacement. Thank you.
The ceramic composites. Actually, I experienced ceramic composites. But you can imagine that to mix with particular layers like apatite. Yeah, it's not it's a viscous material. Yeah, in the production it's not so easy to have the to mix a big uniform distribution of the reinforcement, just like you can see apatite and in the formula. So that means the several requirements, just like a size and shape. If the shape is just like fairly like this, then you know what we then what the matrix there is a part maybe you say to text. That means that this is there is in the service of the percentage volume of the reinforcement, that means the failure, that will be determine the properties, mechanical properties. Of course, several types of wood, there is a special, certain mechanical properties. So, it can be made of composite. Mesh of the knees with the mechanical properties of the bone. If you want to have the high mechanical properties, the volume of the percentage of the hardware component should be so the size of reinforcement, the size of just like a package like this, you cannot make the uniform distribution if the size is not.
Maybe this is the answer to your question. buat division kita kalau bisa di
Thank you very much. Let us give a brief
brief session for handovering appreciations to the three invited speakers. So for the first invited speakers, which is Professor Dr. Hassan from Haiti, we'd like to invite Mr. Bagami and Mr. Haji to hand over appreciations.
And please, to Dr. Suandri MSE to hand over a token of appreciation for Professor Dr. Jawarni S. Sujuko.
Mr. B. Sulaiman, PhD, to hand over a token of appreciation.